And it is, you know, it is again about power and money and control. And like you said, you know, we start off with that. We start off with three-fifths, right? And three-fifths was a compromise that was around power, right? Around political power and making sure that the South had some semblance of power for the number of enslaved people that were in those states to help them with the Electoral College, et cetera. And then you move through, you know, we have disenfranchisement laws around people with felony convictions because, you know, solely because that was the post-Reconstruction era way of making sure that newly freed Black folks could not participate, right, by criminalizing them and saying, we criminalized you and now you can't vote. Then we have all of the Jim Crow laws that, you know, it is the bubbles in the bar of soap or the number of jelly beans or the literacy test, as you said, or the grandfather clauses, et cetera. And, you know, we get the Civil Rights Act of the Voting Rights Act of 1965. But that didn't stop discrimination in voting, right? I mean, it just gave us like a tool as lawyers to use to try and fight it. And so now we are in an era where we're still enforcing what is left of that law. And, you know, the playbook just changes a chapter, right? The playbook of voter suppression. So next chapter, right? The chapter after Obama was elected and there was white lash around his election was a chapter on voter ID. And voter ID became the tool of choice that was really targeted at Black and Brown voters and young voters and our elders, right, who may not have had access to very restrictive voter ID. It wasn't just any old ID. It was like, did you have your name, your address, current address, your signature, and a photo on the ID? And so it wasn't as simple as, oh, everybody's got ID. No, not this ID. And so then it was voter ID. And, you know, and it's been purging. And it's now, you know, what we're going to see after this election is going to be the attacks on vote by mail, because initially that was like Republicans were using that. And, you know, and they loved it. But then their boy Trump was like, he was like, oh, no, that's fraudulent. We can't use it. So then they didn't use it and we used it. And so now that we use it, they're, no, we're not gonna, we gotta put an end to that, right? And that's actually fraudulent now that that those other people have been using it. And so, you know, this is the push and pull that is about the changing demographics of America, because the more that we see the browning of America, the more we're going to see attempts to restrict our ability to tap into our political power. And so no, it is not gonna be over. Even if the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act gets passed by Congress, although it's sitting there because Mitch McConnell cares more about getting judges on the bench, Republican conservative judges who are unqualified on the bench, he cares more about that than voting rights and COVID. Even if we get that passed, we're still going to be fighting the fight. And that's because, you know, the people who have power want to keep power, right?
Right.
And, you know, and it's not that they're scared, right? Like, I hate when people say, oh, they're scared of what they ain't scared. They just know that they want to benefit from the idea of power. And it's like power to them is a limited thing, right? And so you can't share it with a bunch of people. And if you share it with somebody, that means you lose something to them. And so they don't want to share it. And so that's what this is about. And, you know, the browning of America is like to them, like, you know, like the last stand of Custer, or, you know, like, it's like, we gotta, you know, we really have to make sure that we hold on to this. It's the last stand of white supremacy.